There was a time I used to look into my father's eyes. In a happy home, I was a king, I had a golden throne. Those days are gone, now the memories on the wall. I hear the songs from the places where I was born. Upon a hill across the blue lake, that's where I had my first heartbreak. I still remember how it all changed. My father said, don't you worry, child. See, heaven's got a plan for you. Don't you worry now.
Who's you? Good afternoon and welcome to WASA Distance Education. My name is Greg Weaver and this is ENG3C, Grade 11, College English. I'd like to welcome everyone listening across the North today at home, your learning center, or on Bell Express U. To call and join our class, you can call 1-800-465-7144 or 737-4017 or 2983. From the Sulacoat, Lac Seul, or Dryden area. I'd like to welcome everyone back to class today. This is our third class of the week, and we have one more class. Remember, here at WASP, we do not have classes on Fridays, so we do have just one more class. What we're doing today is we're going to keep working through Lesson 2, and we're going to start reading through our course novel. Now we're going to, there's no assignments to do with the course novel. We are going to start reading it. That way it's not as much to do by the time we get to unit number 3, which we really start examining the novel. And so I want to encourage you to start reading the novel now. You can just do little bits at a time. Just follow along as we go. And just work just to get as much done as you can. So we're going to finish off looking, we started at yesterday, looking at news reports, and then we're going to jump right into the novel. So we ended off class yesterday, starting with Unit 1, Lesson 2. And we look at the basic news article format. Now, what this is just a basic outline of how a news report is set up. And every news report that you read will be structured or set up in the exact same way. And we're looking at an example here, which is on page 17 of unit number 1. So it says, money owed accused, says source. We started reading this through. We'll start it again. So this has all of our parts, our headline, our byline, our lead, our quote, and our background information. The headline is money owed accused, source. So that catches your attention, makes you want to keep reading it. That's the headline. The byline gives you a bit more information, as well as tells you who's the author, who wrote this. And in this case, it is Bob Mitchell. It says, former trucker may have been $3,000 behind. This is auto man accused of slaying one man and trying to kill two others, has been trying to collect several thousands of dollars from the Mississauga company where the shootings occurred. The Star has learned. A source close to the investigation said the accused was having difficulty getting money from Liquid Terminals Limited after he left the ball collar. It's not known exactly how much money was owed, but the sources said it was more than $3,000. Although Peel homicide investigators won't say why they believe the three men were shot, the source told the Star there was a long-standing dispute between the company and a driver who hauled liquid cargo on contract. So all that there is our lead. It tells us who, what, where, when, why, now. Who was involved, what happened, where was it, when, why, and how did it happen? This is a 49-year-old man, Ottawa man, remains under a suicide watch in his jail cell, charged with one count of first-degree murder and two counts of attempted murder. The next is our quote. One source told the Star drivers were required to post a substantial amount, about $2,500, when they begin driving for the company. That money is held but later returned if they leave the company. Now, it doesn't say where that comes from, it just says from a source. Michael O'Rourke, 47, of Newmarket, died from gunshot wounds at the scene in a shooting rampage that took less than 10 minutes. Police say the victims were specifically targeted by the shooter. Jürgen Zimmermann of Dundas and Michael Lloyd Bunny of Brampton were also shot and are now recovering from their wounds. Both men, believed to be in their mid-50s, are key eyewitnesses to O'Rourke's slaying, the police said. Sources say Zimmermann and Bunny worked as dispatchers for the company and were among the people on the plant who chose what routes were given out to drivers that O'Rourke selected. Officials with liquid terminals wouldn't comment yesterday. The accused was one of about 50 drivers working primarily as a subcontractor or a freelance driver, meaning that they are paid by the kilometer. Since the company hauls liquid bulk across North America, there are several long routes that provide drivers with substantial paychecks. So all the last little bit started with Michael O'Rourke, 47. That's all background information. So let's say the article is too long. Something comes up, they need to cut some information. That background information will be the first things that are cut. Because you don't need to know that in order to understand exactly what's happening in the news article. It's nice to know, but it is not required. And that was printed on Tuesday, April 13th, 2004. That's when the article was published. We don't know exactly when the shooting happened, but it was probably sometime just before April 13th, 2004. So that's one part. Now, next we have an article on discrimination in society. But before we look at this article, I want to just start going through our course novel. Now, our course novel is called To Kill a Mockingbird. And it's by Harper Lee. Now, this is known as a classic novel. It's widely read in high schools, and sometimes as far as grade 8, it deals with a lot of discrimination and racism and is told from the point of view of Stout, who is a female, and it's set in, you'll find out where it's set. The time period it's set in is the 1930s. So it's set during the time of the Great Depression. It was originally published in 1960. And so the author is Harper Lee. Now, the author, Harper Lee, just made headlines or just made news about 2 days ago, on Monday, when it was announced that they had found a new manuscript or a rough draft of a novel that she wrote back in early 1960s. It's the sequel to this novel, and it stars almost the exact same characters, but it's set 20 years later. So that novel will be coming out shortly. But before that, this was the only novel that was ever published by Harper Lee. So what we're going to do is we're going to start reading. We're going to read about a chapter every lesson. Now, the reason why we're going to do that is because this book is divided into two parts. There's part one, which consists of I believe it's chapters 1 to 11. I'll have to double check that. It's chapters 1 to 11, and that goes as far as page 149 in your course novel. So page 149. Part 2, which is the rest of the novel, is up to you to read on your own. And we'll talk more about that later on. And so we have our first call just came in. And it's in from Wenamun Lake. Who's in Wenamun today?
Ramona.
Hello, Ramona. So what we're doing, we just finished going through that news article we started yesterday at the end of class, one that's entitled Money Owed Accused. And what we're going to start doing now is we're going to start reading our course novel. Now, we don't actually do assignments with it until we get into lesson three, but it's easier to start reading it now than have to try and rush the whole novel in one unit. So we're going to start reading it, and what we're going to do when you read it, I'm going to display it on my computer screen here, as well as reading it from the novel that you have in front of you. Now, speaking of the novel, do you have a copy of it?
No.
Okay, so there's not Janie or Roxanne don't have a copy in the Learning Center?
There.
Guess you have one?
Yeah.
Perfect. So you can just follow along. If you go on Bridget, you'll see the exact same thing up on Bridget as well. So we're going to start off reading it today, and our goal is to try and get through all of chapter one. Now, chapter one starts at page three and goes as far as page 19. So we'll probably spend probably a bit of today's class. We'll do this today, and we'll do part of it tomorrow as well. And we're going to start with that. So up on Bridget, you'll see it, and we're starting on page three. Now, what is up here on Bridget is the exact same thing that's in the novel you have. The only difference is the page numbers, because the pages aren't the exact same as the PDF you see in front of you. So this is the PDF is 285 pages, and your novel's 376. So it's about 100 pages shorter. So we'll start with this, and we will just go from there. So it's chapter one of To Kill a Mockingbird. If you have any, if you ever get confused as I'm reading, you don't know exactly what's going on, you don't understand some of the terms, just as I'm reading, just interrupt me. I'll be stopping at the end of the sentences to take breaths and everything like that. Just feel free to interrupt me if you have any questions. So chapter one says, when he was nearly 13, my brother Jem got his arm badly broken at the elbow. When it healed, and Jem's fears of never being able to play football were assuaged, He was seldom self-conscious about his injury. His left arm was somewhat shorter than his right. When he stood or walked, the back of his hand was at right angles to his body, his thumb parallel to his thigh. He couldn't have cared less, as long as he could pass and punt. With enough years had gone by to enable us to look back on them, we sometimes discuss the events leading to his accident. I maintain that the Ewells started it all, but Jem, who was 4 years my senior, said it started long before that. He said it began the summer Dill came to us, when Dill first gave us the idea of making Boo Radley come out. I said if we wanted to take a broad view of the thing, it was really began when Andrew Jackson. If General Jackson hadn't run up the creek, Simon Finch never would have paddled up the Alabama. And where would we be if he hadn't? We were far too old to settle an argument with the fist fight, so we consulted Atticus. Our father said we were both right. So just right, I'm going to stop for a second right there. We are at the bottom of the first page. So far, we know the main character's name is Scout. She has a brother 4 years older named Jem. They have a friend, we don't know how old he is, named Dill. Now, we don't know if it's male or female. We just know that their name is Dill. And we know that her father's name is Atticus, and their last name is Finch. So we keep going. Being Southerners, it was a source of shame to some members of the family that we had no recorded ancestors on either side of the Battle of Hastings. Now, the Battle of Hastings was a battle that was fought in England in 1066. And we're not going to worry about that, but that's just what it was. Major battle was fought in 1066. All we have was Simon Finch, a fur-trapping apothecary from Cornwall, whose piety was exceeded only by stinginess. In England, Simon was irritated by the persecution of those who called themselves Methodists at the hands of their more liberal brethren. As Simon called himself a Methodist, he worked his way up across the Atlantic to Philadelphia, thence to Jamaica, then Mobile, and up the St. Stephens. Mindful of John Wesley's strictures on the use of many words in buying and selling, Simon made a pile practicing medicine, but in this pursuit he was unhappy lest he be tempted to doing what he knew was not for the glory of God, as putting on of gold and costly apparel. Still, Simon, having forgotten his teacher's dictum about possession of human chattels, bought 3 slaves and with their aid established a homestead on the banks of the Alabama River, some 40 miles above St. Stephens. He returned to St. Stephens only once to find a wife, and with her established a line that ran high to daughters. Simon lived to an impressive age and died rich. It was customary for men in the family to remain on Simon's homestead, Finch's Landing, and make their living from cotton. The place was self-sufficient, modest in comparison with the empires around it. The landing, nevertheless, produced everything required to sustain life except ice, wheat flour, and articles of clothing supplied by river boats from Mobile. Simon would have regarded with impotent fury the disturbance between the North and the South, and had left his descendants stripped of everything but their land. Yet the tradition of living on the land remained unbroken until well into the 20th century, when my father, Atticus Finch, went to Montgomery to read law, and his younger brother went to Boston to study medicine. Their sister, Alexandra, was the Finch who remained at the landing. She married a taciturn man who spent most of his time lying in a hammock by the river wondering if his trot lines were full. When my father was admitted to the bar, he returned to Macomb and began to practice. Macomb, some 20 miles east of Finch's Landing, was the county seat of Macomb County. Atticus's office was in the courthouse, contained little more than a hat rack, a spittoon, a checkerboard, and an unsullied coat of Alabama. His first two clients were the last two persons hanged in the Macomb County Jail. Atticus urged them to accept the state's generosity in allowing them to plead guilty to second-degree murder and escape with their lives. But they were Haverfords, and Macomb County named synonymous with that word I can't say on the radio. The Haverfords, having been dispatched by Macomb's leading blacksmith, a misunderstanding arising, or sorry, the Macombs had dispatched Mayorford's leading blacksmith, a misunderstanding about rising the alleged wrongful detention of a mayor, were impudent enough to do so in the presence of three witnesses, and insisted that the son of a gun, had it coming to him, was good enough defense for anybody. They persisted in pleading not guilty to first-degree murder. There was nothing that Atticus could do for his clients except be present at their departure. An occasion that was probably the beginning of my father's profound distaste for the practice of criminal law. So far, we're only, we're three pages in. We know that Atticus, that their father Atticus is a lawyer, and they have a long history in the area, and that they live in Macomb, which is the county seat or the capital of the area, and they live in Alabama, which you're not sure that is. It's a southern U.S. state that borders the Gulf of Mexico, so it's down the in the southern U.S. So keep going. During his first 5 years in Macomb, Atticus practiced economy more than anything. For several years thereafter, he invested his earnings in his brother's education. John Hale Finch was 10 years younger than my father and chose to study medicine at a time when cotton was not worth growing. But after getting Uncle Jack started, Atticus derived a reasonable income from the law. He liked Macomb. He was Macomb County born and bred. He knew his people, they knew him, and because of Simon Finch's industry, Atticus was related by blood or marriage to nearly every family in town. Macomb was an old town, but it was a tired old town when I first knew it. In rainy weather, the streets turned to red slop. Grass grew in the sidewalks, the courthouse sagged in the square. Somehow it was hotter then. A black dot suffered on a summer's day. Bony mules hitched the Hoover carts, flicked flies, and sweltering shaved the live oaks on the square. Men's stiff collars wilted by 9 in the morning. Ladies bathed before noon for after the 3 o'clock naps. By nightfall were like soft tea cakes of frosting to sweat and sweet talcum. People moved slowly then. They ambled across the square, shuffled in and out of the stores around it, took their time with everything. The day was 24 hours long, but seemed longer. They were in no hurry, for there was nowhere to go, nothing to buy, and no money to buy it with. Nothing to see outside the boundaries of Macomb County. But a time of vague autism for some of the people. Macon County was recently been told it was had nothing to fear but fear itself. We lived in the main residential street. Atticus, Jim, and I, plus Calpurnia, our cook. Jim and I found our father satisfactory. He played with us, read to us, and treated us with courteous detachment. Calpurnia was something else again. She was all angles and bones. She was nearsighted. She squinted. Her hand was as wide as a bed slat and twice as hard. She was always ordering me out of the kitchen, asking me why I couldn't behave as well as Jim, and she already knew he was older, and calling me home when I wasn't ready to come. Our battles were epic and one-sided. Calpurnia always won, mainly because Atticus always took her side. She had been with us since Jem was born, and I had felt her tyrannical presence as long as I could remember. Our mother died when I was 2, and I never felt her absence. She was a grand from Montgomery. Atticus met her when he was first elected to the state legislature. He was middle-aged then. She was 15 years his junior. Jem was the product of their first year of marriage. 4 years later, I was born. And 2 years later, our mother died of a sudden heart attack. They said it ran in her family. I did not miss it, but I think Jem did. He remembered it clearly, and sometimes in the middle of the night, he would sigh at length. Then go, or middle of the game, he would sigh at length, go off, and play by himself by the car hose. He was like that, I knew better than to bother him. When I was almost 6, and Jem nearly 10, our summertime boundaries, which were within the calling distance of Calpurnia, for Mrs. Henry Lafayette Dubose's house 2 doors north of us, and the Radley place 3 doors to the south. We were never tempted to break them. The Radley place was inhabited by an unknown entity, with a description of whom was enough to make us behave for days on end. Mrs. Dubose was plain heck. That was a summer that Dill came to us. Early one morning, as we were beginning our day's play in the backyard, Jim and I heard something next door of Miss Rachel Haverford's colored patch. We went to the wire fence to see if it was a puppy. Mrs. Rachel's rat terrier was expecting. And instead, we found someone sitting looking at us. Sitting down, he wasn't much louder than the collards. We stared at him until he spoke. "Hey. Hey yourself," Jem said pleasantly. "I'm Charles Baker Harris," he said. "I can read." So what?" I said. "I just thought you need to know I can read. You got anything needs reading, I can do it." "How old are you?" asked Jem. 4 and a half? I'm going on 7. "Shoot, no wonder then," said Jem, jerking his thumb at me. "Scout Yonis here has been reading ever since she was born. And she ain't even started school yet. You look right puny for going on 7. "I'm little, but I'm old," he said. Jem brushed his hair to get a better look. "Why don't you come over, Charles Baker Harris?" he said. "Lord, what a name. It's no farther than yours. Aunt Rachel says your name is Jeremy Atticus Finch." Jem scowled. "I'm a fit enough, big enough to fit mine," he said. "Your name is longer and you aren't. I bet it's a foot longer." "Folks call me Dill," said Dill, struggling under the fence. "Do it better if you go over it instead of under," I said. "Where'd you come from?" Dill was from Meridian, Mississippi, and was spending the summer with his aunt, Miss Rachel, who will be spending every summer in Macomb from now on. His family was from Macomb originally. His mother worked for a photographer in Meridian, and entered his picture in a beautiful child contest and won $5. She gave the money to Dill, who went to the picture show 20 times on it. "The only picture shows here, except for Jesus ones in the corridor sometimes," said Jim. "Ever see anything good?" Jill had seen Dracula, revelation that moved Jim to eye him with the beginning of respect. "Tell us about it," he said. There was a curiosity. He wore blue linen shorts that buttoned to his shirt. His hair was snow white and stuck to his head like duck fluff. He was a year my senior, but I towered over him. As he told us the old tale, his blue eyes would lighten and darken. His laugh was sudden and happy. He habitually wore a cowlick in the center of his forehead. When Dill reduced Dracula to dust, Jem said the show sounded better than the book. I asked him where his father was. "You ain't seen nothing about him." "I ain't got one." "Is he dead?" "No." "Then if he's not dead, you've got one, haven't you?" Dill blushed, and Jem told me to hush, assuring that Dill had been studied and found acceptable. Therefore, the summer passed in routine contentment. Routine contentment was improving our treehouse that rested between 2 giant chinaberry trees in the backyard, fussing, running through our list of dramas based on works of Oliver Optic, Victor Appleton, and Edgar Rice Burroughs. In this matter, We're lucky to have Dill. He played the character parts formerly thrust upon me. The ape in Tarzan, Mr. Crabtree in the Rover Boys, Mr. Damon in Tom Swift. Thus we came to know Dill as a pocket Merlin, whose head teemed with eccentric plans, strange loungings, and quaint fancies. But by the end of August, our repertoire was vaped from countless reproductions. And it was that Dill gave us the idea of making Boo Radley come out. The Radley place fascinated Dill. In spite of our warnings and explanations, it drew him as a moon draws water. But it drew him no nearer than the light pole on the corner. A safe distance from the Radley gate. There he would stand, his arm around the fat pole, staring and wondering. The Radley place jutted into a sharp curve beyond our house. Walking south, one faced its porch. The sidewalk turned and ran beside the lot. The house was low. It was once white with a deep front porch and green shutters, but had long ago darkened to the color of slate gray yard around it. Rain-rotted shingles drooped over the eaves of the veranda. Oak trees kept the sun away. The remains of a picket drunkenly guarded the front yard, a swept yard that was never swept, where Johnson grass and rabbit tobacco grew in abundance. Inside the house lived a malevolent phantom. People said he existed, but Gemma had never seen him. People say he went out at night when the moon was down and peeped in windows. When people's azaleas froze in a cold snap, it was because he breathed on them. Any stealthy small crimes committed to make him were his work. One time was terrorized by a series of morbid nocturnal events. People's chickens and household pets were found mutilated. Although the couple was Crazy Addie, who eventually drowned himself in Barker's Eddie, people still looked at the Radley place, unwilling to discard their initial suspicions. A Negro would not pass the Radley place at night. He would cut across the sidewalk opposite and whistle as he walked. The Makeham school grounds adjoined the back of the Radley lot, for the Radley chicken yard, tall pecan trees, shook the fruit into the schoolyard, but the nuts lay untouched by the children. Radley pecans would kill you. Mr. Into the Radley yard was a lost ball, and no questions asked. The misery of the house was many years before Joe and I were born. The Radleys, welcome anywhere in town, kept to themselves, a predilection, unforgivable in Makeham. They had not go to church, Makeham's principal recreation, but worshipped at home. Mrs. Radley seldom, if ever, crossed the street for a mid-morning coffee break with her neighbors, and was certainly never joined a missionary circle. Mr. Radley walked to town 11:30 every morning and came back promptly at 12, sometimes carrying a brown paper bag that neighbors soon contained the family groceries. I never knew how Mr. Radley made his living. Jim said he bought cotton, a polite term for doing nothing. But Mr. Radley and his wife had lived there with their two sons as long as anybody could remember. The shutters and doors of the Radley place were closed on Sundays. Another thing alien to Makeham's ways. Closed doors meant illness and cold weather only. Of all days, Sunday were the best day for formal afternoon visiting. Ladies wore corsets, men wore coats, children wore shoes. But to climb the Radley front steps and say, "Hey," of a Sunday afternoon was something that their neighbors never did. The Radley house had no screen doors. Once I asked Atticus if it ever had any, Atticus said yes before I was born. According to neighborhood legend, when the younger Radley boy was in his teens, he became acquainted with some of the Cunninghams from Old Sarum, a Norris and confusing tribe domiciled in the northern part of the county. And they formed the nearest thing to a gang ever seen in Makeham. They did little, but enough to be discussed by a town and publicly warned upon three pulpits. They were in the barbershop. They rode the bus to Abbotsville on Sundays and went to the picture show. They attended dances at the country's riverside gambling, the Dewdrop Inn and fishing camp. They experimented with stump hole whiskey. Nobody in Makeham had ever told Mr. Radley his boy was with the wrong crowd. One night, in an excessive spurt of high spirits, the boys backed around the square in a borrowed flivver, resisted arrest on Makeham's ancient beetle, Mr. Connor, and locked him in the courthouse outhouse. The town said something had to be done. Mr. Connor said he knew who each and every one of them was. He was bound to determine that he wouldn't get away with it. But the boys came for the probate judge and charges of disorderly conduct, disturbing the peace, assault and battery, and using abusive and profane language in the presence of a hearing of a female. The judge asked Mr. Connor why he included the last charge. Mr. Connor said they cussed so loud he was sure every lady in Makeham heard them. The judge decided to send the boys to the state industrial school, where the boys were sometimes sent for no other reason than to provide them with food and decent shelter. It was no prison, And it was no disgrace. Mr. Radley thought it was. If the judge leased Arthur, Mr. Radley would see that Arthur gave no further trouble. When Mr. Radley's word was at bond, the judge was glad to do so. The other boys attended the industrial school and received the best secondary education to be had in the state. One eventually worked through the engineering school at Albert. The doors of the Radley house were closed on the weekends. And Mr. Radley's boy was not seen again for 15 years. But there came a day, barely within Jem's memory, when Boo Radley was heard from and seen by several people, but not by Jem. He said Atticus never talked much about the Radleys. When Jem would question him, his only answer was for him to mind his own business and let the Radleys mind theirs. They had a right to. But what happened to Jem, said Atticus, shook his head and said, So you received most of the information from Miss Stephanie Crawford, a neighbor whose neighborhood scold, who said she knew the whole thing. According to Miss Stephanie. Sorry, I lost my spot there. Boo was seen delivering cutting items from the Macomb Tribune to paste in his scrapbook. His father entered the room. As Miss Radley passed by, Boo drove the scissors into his parents' leg, pulled them out, and wiped them on his pants and resumed his activities. Mrs. Radley ran screaming into the street that Arthur was killing them all. When the sheriff arrived, he found Boo still sitting in the living room, cutting up the Tribune. He was 33 years old that day. Miss Stephanie told old Mr. Radley that no Rad was going to any asylum. Even suggested the season in Tuscaloosa might be helpful to Boo. Boo wasn't crazy, he was just high-strung at times. It was all right to shut him up, Mr. Radley conceded, but insisted that Boo not be charged with anything. He was not a criminal. The sheriff hadn't heard it hard to put him in jail alongside Negroes, so Boo was locked in the courthouse basement. Boo's transition from the basement back home was nebulous in Jen's memory. As Stephanie Crawford said, some of the town council told Mr. Radley that if he didn't take Boo back, Boo would die of mold from the damp. Besides, Boo could not live forever in the bounty of the county. Nobody knew from what form of intimidation Mr. Radley employed to keep Boo out of sight. But Jem figured that Mr. Radley kept him chained to the bed most of the time. Atticus said no. It wasn't that sort of thing, but there were other ways of making people into ghosts. My memory came alive to see Mr. Radley occasionally open the front door, walk to the edge of the porch, and pour water on our canis. But every day, Jem and I would see Mr. Radley walking to and from town. He was a thin, leathery man with colorless eyes, so colorless they didn't reflect light. His cheekbones were sharp and his mouth was wide, a thin upper lip and full lower lip. But Stephanie Crawford said he was so upright he took the word of God as his only law. We believed her, because Mr. Radley's posture was ramrod straight. He never spoke to us. When he passed, we'd look at the ground and say, "Good morning, sir," and he would cough and reply. Mr. Radley's elder son lived in Pensacola. He came home at Christmas, and there was one of the few persons we ever saw enter leave the place. The day Mr. Radley took Arthur home, people said the house died. But there came a day when Atticus had told us he'd wear his elbow if he made any noise in the yard, and commissioned Calpurnia to serve in his absence if he heard a sound out of us. Mr. Radley was dying. He took his time about it. Wooden sawhorses blocked the road at each end of the Radley lot. Straw was put down on the sidewalk. Traffic was diverted to the back street. Dr. Reynolds parked his car in front of our house and walked to the Radleys every time he called. Jim and I crept around the yard for days. At last, the sawhorses were taken away, and we stood watching the front porch. Mr. Radley made his final journey past our house. And there was the meanest man God ever blew breath into, murmured Calpurnia. And she spat meditatively towards the yard. He looked at her in surprise, for Calpurnia really commented on the ways of white people. The neighborhood thought Mr. Radley would under Boo would come out, but had another thing coming. Boo's elder brother returned from Pensacola, took Mr. Radley's place. The only difference between him and his father was their ages. Just as Mr. Nathan Radley bought cotton too. Mr. Nathan would speak to us, however. We said good morning, and suddenly we saw him coming from town with a magazine in his hand. The more we told Deb about the Radleys, the more he wanted to know, the longer he would stand hugging the light pole in the corner, the more he would wonder. What do he does in there? He would murmur. Looks like he just sticks hell at the door. Jem said he goes out at night, it's pitch dark, but Stephanie Crawford said she woke up in the middle of the night one time and saw him looking straight through a window at her, and said his head was like a skull looking at her. Had he ever waked up at night and heard him, Dill? He walks like this. Jim slid his feet to the gravel. Do you think Miss Rachel is locked up tight at night? I've seen his tracks in our backyard many a morning. One night I heard him scratching at the back room. He was gone by the time Atticus got there. Wonder what he looks like, said Dill. Jim gave a reasonable description of Boo. 6.5 feet tall, judging from his tracks, he died in raw squirrels and ate any cats he had catch. His hands are his bloodstained. If he ate animal raw, you could never wash the blood off. A long jagged scar across his face, his teeth he had were yellow and rotten, his eyes popped and drooled most of the time. Let's try making him come out, said Dill. Let's see what he looks like. Jim said if Dill wanted to go get himself killed, all he'd do was go up and knock on the front door. Our first raid came to pass only because Dill bet Jem the Grey Ghost against two Tom Swifts that Jem would never gain far in the Radley Gate. In all his life, Jem had never declined a dare. And Jem thought about it for 3 days. Suppose he loved honor more than his head. For Dill wore him down easy. You're scared, said Dill. The first day, ain't just scared, just speckled, said Jem. The next day, Dill said, you're just scared to put your big toe in the front yard. Jem said he reckoned he wasn't. He passed the Radley place every school day of his life. Always running, I said. But Dill got him the third day. We said Jem was folks in Meridian certainly weren't afraid of folks in Makeham. He never seen such scary folks as the ones in Makeham. That was enough for make Jem march to the corner, where he stepped and leaned against the light pole, watching the gate hang crazily at its homemade hinge. We got through your head that he'll kill each one of us, Dill Harris, said Jem. Don't blame him when he gouges your eyes out. You started, remember. You're still scared, said Dill patiently. Jem wanted Dill to know once and for all that he wasn't scared of nothing. I can't think of any way to make him come out without him getting us. Besides, Jem had a little sister to think of. When he said that, I knew he was afraid. Jem had his little sister to think of any time I got daring to jump off the top of the house. If I got killed, who'd become of you? He asked. He then jumped, landing hurt, and a sense of responsibility left him to be confronted by the Radley place. You're going to run out on a dare? Asked Dill. If you are, then Dill, you have to think about these things, Jem said. Let me think a minute. It's sort of like making a turtle come out. How's that? Asked Dill. Strike a match under him. I told Jem that if he set fire to the Radley house, I would go to tell Atticus on him. Dill said striking a match on Char was hateful. Ain't hateful, just persuades him. It's not like you chuck him in the fire, Jem growled. How do you know a match won't hurt him? Turtles can't feel stupid, said Jem. We have a turtle, huh? My stars, though. Don't let me think. Figure we could rock him. Dill said so long in thought that Dill made a mild concession. Once he ran out there, I'll swap you gone goals if you go up and touch the house. Jem Brighton, touch the house, that's all? Dill nod. Sure that's all now? Or don't you holler about something different the minute that I get back. Yeah, that's all. Dill's like, he'll probably come out after you and sees you in the yard. Then Scout me will jump on him and hold him down so he can tell him we ain't gonna hurt him. We left the corner across the side street that ran in front of the Radley house and stopped at the gate. Well, go on, said Dill. Scout me, you're right behind you. I'm going, said Jim. Don't hurry me. He walked to the corner of the lot, then back again, studying the civil terrain and deciding how best to effect an entry, frowning and scratching his head. Then I sneered at him. Jim threw open the gate and sped to the side of the house, slapped it with his palm, and ran back to us. Now waiting to see if his foray was successful. Dill and I followed him on his heels. Safely on our porch, panting and out of breath, we looked back. The old house was the same, droopy and sick, but as we stared down the street, we saw an inside shutter move, flick. Almost invisible movement, and the house was still. So that's chapter one of our course novel. So we're going to jump back into lesson number two, and we're going to keep looking at an article that's based on discrimination. And we're going to chance to read the article today. And then we'll work with it again tomorrow. So the article is based on discrimination. It says, read the article below. This is on page 18. This article explores an example of discrimination in today's society and reminds us that discrimination has not been eliminated yet. look at the title of the article. Based on that title, what group is probably experiencing discrimination? What form is that discrimination going to take? As you read, identify the five main elements of a news article. Remember, those are the introduction, supporting details, the conclusion, the transitions, and that, as well as the headline, byline, lead, quotation, and background information. So, it says, lesbian kiss cut from BC school play. By Jeremy Hainsworth, Canadian Press. Drama students say their school district is being homophobic after a play featuring a same-sex kiss was censored after the night's first performance. Broken Theory. Written by students in the drama program at Hainsworth Secondary School, had its debut in North Vancouver's 700-seat Centennial Theatre on April 1st. A drama teacher, David Beer, said it's about finding the meaning of utopia. One of the characters finds the girl of his dreams and kisses her. Two lesbian characters then kiss. It was the most innocuous kiss, he said. It was like a peck between two sisters that a mother and a daughter would do. That peck, though, spurred four parents and three teachers to complain about the kiss and some swearing, Mr. Beale said. I was ordered to take it out, he said, knowing the swearing was allowed back in. Why do seven people get to dictate how our piece is going to unfold? Asked Mr. Bear, who's trained in counseling psychology and the related use of drama. He accused the district of being homophobic, adding many of his students are homosexual. They're just avoiding the issue, said Mr. Bear, said district officials. It's a taboo subject and they just want it to go away. What kind of messages are we sending to our kids? School board chairman Janine Diebolt said it's not the case. We don't believe that to be the truth at all, said Ms. Diebolt. We can't be so sexually visual in all things. I'm not talking lesbian or homosexual. I'm talking all things. She said the entire play needed to be toned down. It was over the top for the community appeal, and not what a high school play should have, Ms. Diebolt said. The principal did receive some complaints regarding the language and some sexually explicit scenes. Devin Johnson, a 2001 Hainsworth graduate, saw the play. She's upset the kiss was been censored. It was a wonderful, wonderful play, Ms. Johnson said. It was done with so much class. They kiss. It's even the main storyline. It's innocent. It wasn't crass or rude. Censoring the lesbian kiss is discreetly saying that homosexual life is not okay. But heterosexual kisses are, she said. When she first heard about there being parental complaints, Mrs. Johnson thought they were talking about a rape scene in the play. The school's plays frequently deal with edgy issues such as drug addiction, raves, and suicide. Ms. Johnson said, adding she's unimpressed with her alma mater. Mr. Bear said the issue prompted him to go home and propose to his same-sex partner of 12 years. For this place, topics such as queer youth and homophobia were at the top of my list, Mr. Bear said. Now they are. I will not be censored. I will not be getting shut about it. Who thought of a first female-female kiss would change my life? It's not the first time accusations of intolerance have swirled on Hainsworth. There was a BC Human Rights Commission complaint 3 years ago about how a student was treated by some of his peers. That complaint brought an admonishment from the commission. In 2001, a commission tribunal ruled the district had been discriminated against Hainsworth student Azmi Zubran based on its perceived sexual orientation when it failed to stop students who assaulted him for a turn from calling him gay, queer, and faggot. Mr. Zubran said he was a heterosexual. The tribunals found that although Hainsworth administrators took positive, appropriate steps to deal with Mr. Jubin's tormentors, their actions weren't sufficient. It said, if the district failed to provide school administrators with tools and training they needed to make a difference. The BC Supreme Court later canceled the decision, saying it was flawed as there was no discrimination based on sexual orientation. Ms. Johnson wondered whether the school would learn anything from the two incidents. I think Hainsworth really isn't focused on what the youth need, she said. I think they focused on looking good. They should be proud of their students taking initiative to go back to explain to everyone exactly what's going on. So I've read the issue of article above. Were your predictions correct? The main topic is homophobia that's happening in a school in BC. Discrimination is occurring in the form of censorship. The play has been altered in order for the drama students to be permitted to perform it. You base those predictions on the headline. The author's article found the byline is Jeremy Hainsworth. Leads composed of the first two paragraphs. It gives the following information. Who was involved with drama students at Hainsworth Secondary School? What happened or school district censored their play? Why? What featured a same-sex kiss? Where in North Vancouver, BC? When April 1st, 2004? And how this came about, the school district responded to homophobic complaints. There are many quotes throughout the article. Some quotes are from the school board officials. These are balanced by quotes from people against the censorship. Finally, the article's last 8 paragraphs are background information, letting the reader know that the Haynesworths have a problem with accusations of intolerance in the past. All right, that's where we'll end. We will work through the support questions tomorrow, as well as looking at key question number 2. We will finish that tomorrow, and we'll get started with lesson 3 as well. That's what I'm for tonight. Thanks, Ramona and Wonderman Lake, and everyone who listened in. Any questions, be sure to give me a call. I am away from the office on Friday. So if you have any questions, you have to email them. But I am away on Friday. Other than that, hope everyone has a good night. I'll talk to everyone again tomorrow. Till then, McGwitch, and bye for now.